Daniel with Cable Bullet. Today we're going to look at the Signature Series side mount post with modern top. We'll be giving you a review of the system and installation instructions. The Signature Series side mount post will come with a post body and a bracket to attach it at different points on your deck. Here we have a end bracket. So this is a bracket you'll use to attach an end post. Here we have a mid post bracket. This is an inside corner bracket. And here we have an outside corner bracket. Each bracket is designed so that the mounting screw, the large structural mounting screws, will be eventually hidden by the post as it sets in the bracket. Here we have an intermediate post, and it has a slim intermediate bracket. The intermediate bracket slips on again, capturing the post. With the slim intermediate bracket, we have a custom screw that fits down inside to anchor it to the structure. Here we have the end bracket for the 2x2 posts. As with all these 2x2 brackets, they can take either our custom screw or our GRK structural screw. However, the GRK screw will not work with the intermediate post. Only the custom screw will work in that application. This is the modern top for the Signature Series post. It is an exterior collar that mounts on an interior column. Column is affixed to the post with a 1/4-20 screw. This collar will affix with a set screw in the side. The collar will mount to the bottom of the handrail, slip over the column, and be attached that way. To mount this collar to the handrail, we have some double-sided tape that sticks on there just to help you align it so you know exactly where it's going to go. And then you'll use a screw through the bottom of that into the handrail. Here we have the intermediate Signature Series side mount post with a modern top. The top on this intermediate can pivot for stair applications, for when the handrail is descending the stair. You can see that can pivot, and then when you have it in position, you can tighten it down. It has holes on the side that allow you to affix it to the handrail. We're going to take a look next at how to install the system. We'll give a brief overview of some of the things to look for as you begin to lay out the post location, and then we'll take you step by step through the installation of each type of post. When we're considering post placement, we're going to start with looking at the transition spaces on the deck. In this case, we have an upper deck. It's transitioning down to a landing. It's going to go down a set of stairs here. Because we have two level rails here, we want our cable to line up going through that space. So we're going to check the distance between these two levels, and we're right at about 6 1/4 inches between these two level sections of the deck. This whole deck is going to take a 36-inch high rail system, except for right at this one spot. And we're going to use a 42-inch post to help make that 6-inch transition. The 36-inch rail here will come to the top of this 42-inch post that's mounted on the lower section. So the 6-inch difference between the two is going to be absorbed in this taller post. Then we'll switch to 36 on the rest of the deck. So not all decks have a nice 6-inch transition. You may find that when you have transitions that 6-inch increment isn't working for you, so the single 42 may not be a good option. In that case, two 36-inch end posts could work nicely. One mounted on the higher deck, one mounted on the lower deck. Just make sure that the spacing between those two posts doesn't exceed 4 inches so that you will meet your code requirement. now that we've looked at our kind of our transition space, which is where you want to start, it's the most difficult to make sure you've got things lined up right. We're going to look at the rest of the deck here. For this 20 by 20 deck with one landing and one set of stairs, we're going to be using 6 end posts, 2 two-way posts, 2 outside corners, and 7 intermediate posts. All right, here we are at our transition. And we're going to start by mounting our first bracket here. On these brackets, the hole spacing is 3 inches. The distance between the bottom hole and the top of the bracket is 4.5 inches. That allows you to set the bracket down on the fascia up to 1.5 inches and still have a 3-inch space between the surface of the deck and the first cable. So we're going to look at our transition here between these two spots, set our bracket on the side of this lower level so that it plays out evenly with a 3-inch spacing at this upper deck. All right, to mount our bracket on the side of the deck, we're first going to check how level and plumb that deck section is. And right now I can see that this deck is a fair bit out of level. There's a little bit of a warp to this side of the deck here. So we're going to need to use a shim behind our bracket here to get that to plumb. Okay, we'll use that shim in behind there till we've got a plumb alignment with our bracket. We'll mark the location through the holes and secure our bracket once we have it plumb and level. I'm also going to nudge this bracket up just a little bit more than my 1.5 inch spacing because I had a little more than 6.25 here. So that's going to allow those holes to line pretty well with the deck. So I'm going to mark my first hole. Just going to use a drill bit here in the center of that hole. I'm just using that to mark a location. Okay, now that I've marked my first hole in that bracket, I'm going to use a 3/16 drill bit to as a pilot for my screw. Now we're going to grab one of our custom screws here. It uses a T30 bit, extra long bit there, and I'm going to run that first screw in just part ways, just to get my bracket. Now I've got that bracket set in one plane. I'm going to make sure I'm level. And I'm going to use my drill here to mark a second hole. Once our hole is marked, we'll go ahead and run another pilot hole in. That second pilot hole drilled, we're going to go ahead and run another screw in that location. Okay. At this point, our bracket should be within range of level. There we go. I'm going to mark my last two holes, still leaving my screws a little loose so that I can plumb the bracket in the other direction once I'm done. All right, our bracket is plumb in this direction, and now I'm going to make sure it's plumb in this direction. It's going to take quite a few shims in this case because that deck has got a pretty good warp to it at the top here. But that looks like it'll do it about there. So we'll take some plastic shims here. We're using plastic so that they don't rot in an exterior application here. Okay. I'm gonna drive those in, make sure we're plumb. It looks like when we suck that back, that's gonna level it up pretty good. I'm gonna run a pilot hole through. All right, and you can see our bracket is pretty close to level there. Not a little bit. Might need to draw that in just a little bit. It's important to get your bracket level and plumb so that when you mount your post to it, it will also be level and plumb. Remember that you're adding quite a bit of length to this angle. So if this is out of plumb, your post will be out of plumb. Now that we have our bracket where it's plumb and level, we're happy with it. I'm going to go ahead and cut off our shims and get ready to mount our post to it. Now that we have our bracket nice and level and solidly affixed to the deck, we're going to mount our post on there. This post has pre-tapped holes that align with holes in the bracket for a 1/4-20 screw. So we'll simply line those up, slip it in place. It's helpful to just get the screws started, not too tight on the first one until your other screws have all been started, so that you're not, you have a little bit of wiggle room there to get that threading started in the hole. See there. Okay. All right, now that we have our screws fastened, we'll want to check for level, which looks pretty good. And we're ready to move on to the next post. Now that we're ready to mark out where the rest of our posts are going to go, we're going to start by creating a horizontal line along the side of the deck here. So remember we talked about the fact that this bracket sets 1.5 inches down from the deck surface in a typical application. You can adjust that as you need to for your application, but that would leave you with 3 inches between the surface of the deck and the first cable. So we're going to mark down that 1.5 inches, put a mark there on our side of our deck, and we'll go to the other side, do the same, and snap a chalk line down through here. That'll give us the level line that will mark the top location for the bracket down through here. Then we'll set up and mark where our brackets are going to fall along the side of the deck. All right, we're ready to mark out the location of our posts along our parallel line here. So we've done the math, and we're going to be setting this post at 77 3/8 inches off the corner. Okay. That's going to be our center line, so we've marked it there. And I'm using a level here to get a plumb line. Okay, and that's going to give us our location of our mid post bracket. All right, so we're ready to mount our intermediate bracket here. Remember, we have our parallel line here at the top, so we're going to come right up to that. I've got my center line that I can see right down through my holes here. And I'm going to mark, in this case, I'm going to mark the bottom hole and run a screw in there, because I know I need to shim out the top just a little bit. And then I'll shim out the top and set those top screws as well. Now we're going to mount our bracket with one custom screw and then level from there. So you can see this is where that small-headed screw is important. All right, we've got one screw mounted in the bottom here. Now I'm going to plumb for side to side and mark a second hole on the bottom edge. In this case, I'm going to leave the screws out of the top so I can shim that out just a little bit. I've got that set plumb. Run my pilot hole in. And start a custom screw here on the bottom. I can take a look and see what it looks like and plumb the other direction. Well, that looks pretty good, actually. Side to side, that's spot on.
Slide the intermediate post into the slot and align the holes. Similar to the last post, it is helpful to get the 1/4-20 screws started by hand before tightening them with the 3/16 Allen. Same as the previous post, the corner bracket will be placed 1.5 inches from the deck surface. Repeat the steps for marking and pre-drill for this corner bracket. You will want to make sure you have the proper blocking behind the corner. Note that the screw goes through the bracket at an angle. Secure the bracket through the bottom hole, check for plumb, add shims as necessary to make sure your bracket is straight.
Now that we have our bracket nice and level and solidly affixed to the deck, we're going to mount our post on there. This post has pre-tapped holes that align with holes in the bracket for a 1/4-20 screw. It's helpful to just get the screws started, not too tight on the first one until your other screws have all been started, so that you're not, you have a little bit of wiggle room there to get that threading started in the hole.
Up next is the end bracket. We want to place the post 3 inches from the wall. The end post overhangs the bracket by 1/2 inch. With this in mind, we will make a mark at 3.5 inches away from the wall and 1.5 inches down. This end post bracket will also require some blocking. We will drive screws through this rim joist and add a 4x4 to provide the necessary blocking. To keep this a clean look, we'll place these screws in a location where the bracket will hide them.
All right, with our bracket securely fastened and plumb and level, we're going to go ahead and mount our end post. The way the end post works here is it has two holes again that are threaded for the side, on the side where the tensioners are going to be mounted. So this is an L-shaped bracket. We've got this post set at the top of the stairs, and we're going to look at the rest of the posts on our stair here. I'll back up just a minute here and mention that where we set this top post does affect where the other posts on this run will set. So you need to keep that in mind in setting all your posts on a slope. What we're looking for is to maintain a cable run that is parallel to the slope of the stairs. Okay? You can see that if we move the post up or down, that would affect the height of that cable off the slope of the stairs. But also, because the cable is running at an angle here, if you move this post back or forward, you'll also affect where that cable runs parallel to the stairs. So those are the tricks we have in our bag to work with to line up these posts to get them to run parallel to the stairs. We can move the post up and down, or we can move it front to back, further away from or closer to the slope of the stairs. Ideally, we're going to end up with a position at the top of the stairs and a position at the bottom of the stairs that works nicely for mounting. So we've set this back a little bit from the front. What that does is it draws down the cable towards the stair, and it gives us options at the bottom of the stair to be able to pull that bracket in further onto the mounting surface at the bottom of the stairs. Our next step now is to find out exactly where that bracket needs to set relative to this slope of the stairs. So I'm going to take a little piece of tape here, put it on the side of my post just so I can see my marks. I'm going to take a straight edge or a level and run that up along the side of this post and mark where that intersects the post. Okay. You can see I've got a mark here. Now I can measure the distance down from that mark to the top of my bracket. And I'm right at 1 5/8". There is a little trick here to keep in mind. Because my bullet is going to set about 1/4 inch proud of this face, and the same is true on the bracket at the bottom of the stairs, or on the post at the bottom of the stairs, it does skew that cable a little steeper. Okay, because you're pulling this one out, that one in, it will kick the cable a little bit steeper this way. So to compensate for that, we can make an adjustment on the distance at the bottom or the top for where we set that bracket. It's a very slight adjustment. In most cases, you don't really need to worry about it because it's only a slight fraction of an inch off the top here. But if you're really wanting to get that right on the money, you'll need to take into account the distance the bullet will set out on the face, because that is the point where the cable will begin to slope parallel to the stairs. Here we are at the bottom of the stairs. We've set our top post up there, and we gave you an illustration of how to find where the plane of this skirt board here is intersecting the post, and then how to account for the face of the bullets a little bit further in. Okay, so now we're going to replicate that on the bottom of the stairs here. So I'm going to use my level here just to help me have a crisp edge to visualize against here. I've got my end post bracket here, and it'll be mounting with the face of it here, the extending leg, towards the side where the cable's gonna go. So it's gonna set like this on this side here. I'm looking to keep it level as I mount it on there. And then I'm looking to find the distance up and down where it's going to keep that cable running through straight, parallel to this skirt board. Okay. At the top, we mentioned that it was at the face of the post, it was 1 5/8". Okay. If we came out 1/4 inch, it was 1 inch and a strong half. So here at the bottom, I've put a mark where this plane is going to intersect my square as it sits on top of my bracket. So now I'm going to locate my bracket, and I'm looking to keep it plumb the whole time. Okay, so I'm gonna put a level on there and I can watch it to make sure it's plumb. Okay. And I'm gonna be looking for the point where my bracket is plumb and the face of the post have the right distance down from the intersecting plane. And there we are, right there. So my mark is aligning with the plane at the top of the stairs. My bracket is plumb. And that is right where we want that bracket to sit. I'm going to go ahead and mark those holes. Oops. Once Since I have a mark there, I'm gonna go ahead and pre-drill a pilot hole and set my first screw. And from there, it's just a matter of leveling the bracket. So now we have a pre-drilled hole. We're going to mount this bracket to that. We'll level it and finish the rest of the screws. I'm going to check for level both directions. So I'm level that way, and I am level that way. So now I can finish off my screws, and my bracket is in the correct location. You can see at the face of the post, I'll be coming through right at the plane of the stairs. All right, with our bracket securely fastened and plumb and level, we're gonna go ahead and mount our end post. The way the end post works here is it has two holes again that are threaded for the side, on the side where the tensioners are gonna be mounted. So this is an L-shaped bracket. And there we have a securely mounted end post at the bottom of the stairs. Now we'll take a look at setting an intermediate post on the stair section. So what I've done, I found the location up and down here where I'd like to have that bracket mounted. Now I just need to find the exact location of that bracket. So I'm going to start by drawing a plumb center line. There we go. So I want my bracket to set right centered over that plumb centered line. Now, to find the height, again, I need to account for the slope of the stairs here. And because the cable passes through the center of our mid post, I'm going to be taking that dimension from the center of my bracket here. Again, I have my square marked. My bracket is centered on my mark, and I'm going to move this up and down until the plane of the skirt board here hits my mark at the center of the bracket. This should ensure that my cable will pass through the center support post there, the intermediate post, and follow the plane of this slope of the stairs. Once I have my bracket location noted here, I'm going to use my drill to mark one of the holes, and I'll continue to secure the bracket from that point. If you notice, I'm using a slightly larger drill bit than my pilot. I'm picking a bit size here that fills most of that hole in the back of this bracket. What that does is it centers the point so that I get a nice starting point for my pilot holes, ensuring that it'll be centered in the hole of the bracket. My pilot hole drilled. Go ahead and mount the first screw, and then check again for plumb and level. Looks like I'm going to need to shim this out a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and put a couple screws in the bottom so I keep my bracket aligned, and then I'll loosen the screw in the top and shim it out just a little bit. Loosen the top. I'm going to slip a little shim in there. All All right, I'm happy with that. Secure my second screw, and we'll have an intermediate post bracket set on the slope of the stairs. After that, we'll move on to the brackets on the opposite side of the stairs, making sure that they mirror and have the right distance down from the script board. We've mounted securely one of our end posts on our stairs, and we want to mount the other one opposite it. So we need to find the point on the other side of the stairs that will mirror this post. I'm going to use this 6-foot level as a straight edge. I'm going to simply bump it up against the back side of the post. Okay. And then use a square to see where I need to fall. There we go. There we go. So this straight edge now is square to the stairs and touching the back of this post. I'm going to mark this side here. Now I've transferred the location of the back side of this post to this side of the stairs. To find the location of the front of the bracket, I'm going to add in the 2 inches of the post and the half inch of this bracket, and that'll give me a point where the front of this bracket will set. From that point, I can find out the distance down it needs to be from this slope of the stairs, and we'll have the location for this bracket that will mirror this post on this side. Here we are on the opposite side of from our first post at the bottom of the stairs. We're ready to mount this bracket. I'm going to find its location. So it's going to be set up about in here. We need to come over the thickness of the post and the bracket. That's 2.5 inches. Okay, so that's going to be right here. That is where the face of that bracket is going to set. So I'm going to go ahead and mark a plumb line there. Okay. So that's the plumb line for the front of my bracket. Now all I need to do is find the distance down from this plane. So just as we did earlier, we're going to use this mark. It's about 1.5 inches. It's what we have marked out as the distance down from that edge that we need to fall. Now, this was at a location where the face of that bullet's going to fall on this post. So that post is going to sit right here. The face of that bullet's going to be right in here. So that's where I need to find my distance down to make sure those are level. That looks like that's right about the spot. Right there's where we want to be. So from there, I'm going to drill and mark to drill my pilot hole for the first screw to mount this bracket. With our bracket securely mounted, we're ready to set our post at the bottom of the stairs. Repeat these steps to complete the post installation on the rest of the stairs. With your posts installed, it's now time to install your metal bullets in the posts. The posts are pre-threaded, so it's a matter of simply screwing the bullet into the post. You can use the driver that's sent with the installation system to, and a socket end wrench to align that bullet just where you want it. In this case, I'm going to set those bullets so that all the threaded tensioning mechanism is at the bottom. And I'll do that on each one of these bullets down the post through all the tensioning posts. Sometimes it's helpful to, on a stairway system, to set the bullet at the top of the stairs with this set screw in the up position. It allows you to access that screw as the cable will be coming out of that bullet at a downward slope. However, everywhere else, I typically put the channel at the bottom of the post. This is where we have a higher handrail coming in on this side, because the deck's a little higher. We have a lower handrail coming in on this side, off the landing. So we'll end up with two holes here at the top that normally would be used for tensioners, but in this case, we won't need them. So we have a post hole plug right here that we'll be putting in there. It sets flush with the face of the post once it's installed, and a spanner bit that installs that plug that will run those right into the top two holes, so it'll fill those spots where the handrail will come in right below. So this is a hole plug that you'll use whenever you need to plug a pre-tapped hole in your tensioning posts. With these bullets all installed now, we'll move on to mounting our top rail. All right, now that we've finished installing our posts, we're gonna move on to installing the handrail on this project. On this project, we're gonna use our aluminum handrail. This is powder coated black. It is a heavy walled aluminum handrail that allows you to span longer spans than you might normally be able to with most handrails. Our installation guide online will tell you exactly how far you can span with this handrail in different applications. Next, we'll take a look at the splines and the accessories that go with this handrail. Let's take a closer look at the particular splines that we'll be using on this project. Okay? There are other splines available for other handrail and other applications, but these are the ones we'll be using for this project. First, we have a structural spline. This is solid aluminum. It's designed to join straight runs of handrail. Slips in one side, the next piece of handrail slides over that, leaving you a very clean joint. And because of the thickness of this aluminum and the structural integrity of our handrail, this joint, this butt joint, can actually happen anywhere along your handrail. You don't have to make this break over top of a post. This can really expedite the installation process and save you on handrail as well. Next, we have a adjustable spline. This you'll use at stair transitions. Allows the handrail to be cut and fitted over a transition from a straight to a sloped application. That adjustable angle can be set and the nut tightened down, and you'll have a fixed angled spline. For outside corners, we have a pre-cut spline set at a 90 degree angle. Again, that can fit right inside the handrail. This can be cut. Once your handrail is cut at a 45, two pieces come together to form a 90 degree angle with this spline here. There are a few situations where you have unique returns or very short runs where you need to make a unique configuration with the handrail. And that's where spline stock can work really nicely to cut and assemble a spline for a unique situation. Most of the time, one of these standard pre-made splines that we have will fit your situation. It's rare that you'll need the spline stock. The last two things that we'll want to take a look at here are the end caps. So this is a piece you'll use to cap the end of the handrail. Fits snugly in there, a nice little pop, and you'll have a fitted end to your handrail. So use this wherever you're terminating the handrail and don't want that open center extrusion shown. All these splines and the handrail affixed to the post tops, all that can be done with our number 8 3/4 inch stainless steel screws. These are designed to go through the aluminum and into the spline, or through the top and into the bottom of the handrail. All right, here we are at our first post where we're going to start assembling the handrail. Wanted to review this modern top. So the modern top has an exterior collar and a center pin. That center pin is fixed with an Allen shoulder bolt. And this collar slips over top and is tightened with a 1/8 inch Allen key. That gives you a very firm top. Now, the reason for coming in here on the side is we can remove this top, allowing us to screw it to the bottom of our handrail and then slide it on and tighten it in place. That's how this will assemble. Next, we're going to take a look at how to cap the end of the handrail, because this is going to be the end of a handrail run. So we're going to cap the end of that handrail and get ready to assemble this part together. All right, because we're ending the handrail at this transition spot, we're going to use one of our handrail end plugs. Okay, that's going to fit in the end of this handrail here, and we'll give it a nice little tap. And that fits in there nice and tight. And now we're ready to set this handrail on top of our modern top and fix the position there so we can screw it and keep moving with our assembly. Here we are with our handrail, our end cap on. I have already pre-installed a double-sided tape ring. Comes with the top, okay? You can see the holes that are in it, organized to fit the top. Peels off both sides, sticks down. Peel off one side, stick it on, peel off the other side, and you'll have a double-sided tape on the top of that collar. That's going to help us just make it real easy to line up our handrail, set it on there, stick it to it, flip it over, and attach the screws. A couple things to remember as we're doing this is I'm going to want to align that handrail with the side, and in this case, the end as well, of this post. So I'm lining it up, centering it over top. It sets in just a little bit on each side. There we go, I'm centered up that way and I'm lined up this way. And I've got that top stuck there and I can lift it up. Now I went ahead and organized this so that the set screw that's going to fasten this is on the outside. That way when we tighten down that set screw, you won't see it from the inside of the deck here. So that allows us to lift up that handrail and flip it over, and you can see my collar there is fixed in place. I'm ready to drill holes, screw it down, set it back down, and tighten up the set screw and have this handrail done. All right, here we've got our collar stuck to the handrail right where we want it. So we're going to use our 5/32 drill bit here, drill down through these holes to create pilots for our sheet metal screws that are going to fix this in place here. Now that I've got a couple of those, I'm going to go ahead and insert a couple screws before I finish the last two holes. Just helps make sure that all our holes are lined up where we want them to be. There we go. We're going to use a handheld screwdriver for this, just to make sure that we don't strip out our screws in this application. We hate to have to redo that handrail part. So now that I've got that in place, I'm going to put two more screws in. Again, the last two screws. This steel screw was able to cut its own thread into that pre-drilled hole. That's what's going to make this work for us here. There we go. All right, now we're ready to set this handrail in place and tighten down our Allen key there. Now with that collar fixed to our handrail here, we're going to flip it back over, set it back down over our center post, use our Allen key here to tighten up the set screw on the side, and now we have that handrail fixed in place. All right, with this handrail fixed at this end, we're going to move on to the next post, fasten the handrail there. Here we are at our intermediate post where we're getting ready to fix the handrail to our intermediate post. I'm going to start by making sure that my post is plumb, right where I want it to be. Yeah, that looks good. Just a fraction of an inch there. Next, I'm going to use a little clamp here to help hold things in place while I'm drilling here. There we go. Okay. It's going to keep our handrail centered nicely and keep it from moving. And then we're going to be drilling up through these intermediate tops. Have a screw, a hole at a little bit of an angle. Comes up alongside the post up into the handrail. So we're going to use our drill here to drill up pilot hole through there and then put our screws in. I'm going to go ahead and put one screw in, make sure I've got everything lined up right where I want it. All right, tightens down nicely, and I'll go ahead and run the other screw in. And there's our intermediate handrail to post connection. Next, we're going to take and spline together two pieces of handrail. This is our structural spline that we introduced earlier. It has a mark here in the middle to indicate halfway through the part. We'll simply slip it in the end, make sure we're halfway through, come up underneath and drill for a set screw. We're also going to countersink so that the head of our screw will fit snugly to the bottom of the handrail. There we go. And we are ready to install our screw to hold this spline securely in place before we assemble the next piece. Go. And now we're ready for sliding on the next section of handrail. Now that we have our structural spline securely in place, we're going to add another section of railing. We'll simply slip over that spline, drop into place. You can add another screw here if you would like. You don't have to, as the whole system will be in compression, holding that joint securely together. Once we have that piece in place, we'll secure our handrail at the next post and keep going with our handrail assembly. Okay. All right, we're ready to install the last section of railing on this run. We're going to make sure, because I didn't screw all those joints together, I'm going to make sure that my handrail is tight up to this point, all compressed. I'm going to take a measurement on my last section, and here I'm measuring from the end of my last piece of handrail to the back side of the post. I'm at 52 1/4. That's going to give me the long side of the miter as I turn the corner with my handrail. So once we have our measurement here, we're going to transfer that to our handrail stick and make that cut. Okay. Here we're using a metal cutting blade and a miter saw. The blade is designed for cutting softer metals like aluminum. Now that we've marked our handrail here, at our mitered cut. I've also taped the end of this cut area. That'll help us to touch up that end if we need to in the next step. So here I'm gonna go ahead and cut that right on my 45 there. All right, here we've cut that, made that cut, miter cut, and you can see it leaves a nice clean cut. We've put some tape around here, which once we've cut through it, gives us a perfect paint shield if we want to touch that up with a little bit of spray paint. This joint looks like it's gonna go together really nicely. And it looks like it will right there, yeah. So we wouldn't need to, touch that up in this case, but if you'd like to make sure that you don't see any of that aluminum look on the inside and you have just the straight black, you can go ahead and spray that with a little bit of touch-up paint on the butt end of the cut, miter cut there. Next, we're going to go ahead and assemble the corner spline and put this corner together. Now that we've made our miter cut in our handrail, we're going to take the second off-fall piece and simply reverse it to make our miter. This is because our handrail is the same on both sides. There's no top or bottom to it, so you can make one cut and create a miter. The next step here is to insert our corner spline on this miter. There we go, and that's going to pull together. Just like that. Now, before we put any screws in here, we're going to want to make sure that we're working from the backside or underside of our handrail. I can see that this face here is going to be the underside of the handrail, so that's where I'll insert my screws. I'm also going to make sure that my screws are out of the way of whatever top mounting bracket I'm using. So I'm going to put my screws out here and out here so that I'm out of the way of where this is going to set. All right, and there we have a completed mitered corner. We're ready to mount our bracket to the top of that. We'll go ahead and use our two-sided tape, set it up, make sure we're right where we want to be, and have that mounted to the handrail. So we've assembled our mitered corner for our handrail. We have a spline and the last section of handrail ready to put these together. I also have my top set on my post with the adhesive tape on it, and I'm organizing the screw holes on the top so that they won't interfere with this seam here when that sticks down. We'll slide this together, stick this top to the bottom of this, that'll give us exactly the location we want. We'll flip it off, put the screws in the back, set it back down, and tighten it up. Come down on our corner. And there we have it. Now we'll go ahead and run our screws in and set our last handrail section in place for the corner. All right, we're here on our work table with our top stuck in right place where we want it to be. So we're going to drill our holes down through there. And I'm going to go ahead and put one screw in, just to hold things in place. All right, with our spline in the adjoining handrail piece, we're ready to set this last piece of handrail to the corner. So I'm gonna slide that in there. There we go. And I'm gonna drop in on here, and we're in place. And I've aligned the set screw on this top to the outside so you won't see it from the deck. And here we can just tighten down that top. There we go. Now that section of handrail is securely fastened around the corner. We'll keep going with the next sections on down to the end of this run. And again, you can see we'll have a structural spline mid-span here as we add our next piece on down to the end. Perfect. Okay, so we're down to the last section of this run of handrail. I'm gonna cut off a small piece here and end the section. We're gonna be putting in a cap on that end. So when we make that measurement, we want to account for the addition, that eighth inch addition of that cap. We'll put this cap in, cut this piece, mount it to our last section there, and move on to a stair section. Safety first. So we've made our cut here, and sometimes you can get a little bit of a burr around the edge of that end. So a fine file or a stiff sanding block can help to clean up some of those burrs if you happen to have them on your piece. I'm going to go ahead and just soften that edge a little bit and then shoot it with a little bit of finish. Have a finished piece there. We'll put in our last spline, our end cap, and complete this section. I'm getting ready to drill for my screw here. And if you notice, I put a little bit of tape on here. Just helps me see how deep to go. It's just a little bit of a guide on that drill bit. The other thing to remember with this drill bit is to be careful and not over drill the hole or wobble in the hole there. You can oversize that hole pretty quickly and then your screw won't engage in the aluminum. So this size of bit, this size of screw will allow the steel screw to cut some thread into that aluminum. But if you wobble a little too much with that drill bit there, you can oversize the hole and leave the threads not very well engaged into the aluminum. Here we're assembling two sections of handrail coming around the corner at this landing and then transitioning down the stairs. With these tops, I'll need to form this angled corner first and be able to have that those pieces together to mount my top to it. So I'm going to measure from the face of my adjacent column there and to the back side of this column. And on this measurement, because I'm going to be mounting an end cap to this post to allow that hand to receive the end of that handrail, I'm going to take off about 1/8 of an inch to this dimension to account for that handrail. So I'm going to be just under 45 inches on that direction. Coming this way, again, I'm coming from the back of the post. That's where the back of my miter, the long point of my miter will be. I'm coming over top. And remember, this is where I want to break to go down the stairs. So my break in the handrail, the underside, is going to fall right in line with these bullets. So I'm just going to use this square to transpose that up, and I'm right at 4 1/4 feet on that dimension. With these dimensions, I'll be able to pre-cut my handrail for these two pieces and assemble them ready to install. For our last cut on this section of rail, we need to transition down the stairs with our handrail. So we need to find out what that angle is going down the stairs. Then we'll divide that angle in two and have the angle that we need to cut that miter at. So here I've used a couple pieces of handrail just to give me a nice flat true representation of the angle going down the stairs. A T-square here. I'm just going to lay it on there until I've got a fit there. There we go. This then is the angle coming across and going down the stairs. I'll transfer this to either a protractor or a piece of plywood that I can mark off my split angle on there and find the exact angle for my cut. We'll do that next. All right, so we found our angle, the slope of our stairs here. Now we need to divide that into a couple ways to do that. If you have a protractor, you can simply find that angle on the protractor. It looks like we're right at 148 degrees on that. If you don't have a protractor, another classical way of finding that angle is lay right out on a, lay your T-square here and mark your line. I'm going to split that so it's a little easier to put my compass on there. Okay, and I'm going to use my compass here. That angle will split right through, and we can readjust to that angle here. It should be half of the 148. Now that we found our angle, we can transfer that to the saw and cut our handrail so that the two halves will come together with a perfect slope to the stairs. So this is the cut angle on the upper stair handrail. We're ready to set the angle on the adjustable spline. This is an adjustable spline, and that can be set to the angle of the stair slope. Just like that, tighten up the bolt, and you'll have that angle. That's what we've done on this piece here. So it's set to the slope of the stairs. With this angle set, we're now ready to insert it into the upper stair transition and assemble the lower stair rail. We're going to go ahead and fasten screws in the back to pull that together. We'll do the same on the corner that was part of this landing transition. We'll have a three-piece handrail section here that we'll have assembled and ready to mount to the top brackets to set on the posts. you go. That's perfect. With this three-piece handrail section fabricated, we're going to now mount our modern top collar on this corner to receive that post. Also, we're going to mount a end cap onto the side of the taller post back here so that it can receive the end of this transition piece here. Here we are with the getting ready to set the end cap mounted to the side of this post so that it will be used as a sleeve to receive the end of this handrail. So the handrail comes in and dies into the side of this post. So we're going to show you here how to set that up. I've got a clamp set about the right spot for where I think that needs to be level. So I'm going to set a piece of handrail along here, okay, and check that for level. All right, looks good. I'm also going to check for level this direction to make sure I'm set just about right. Looks pretty good. And now that the backside of this clamp is forming the spot where I need to set that end cap. I'll go ahead and pre-drill some holes and countersink so that I can use my sheet metal screws to attach this end cap to this post. That'll be our next step. All right, here we're gonna pre-drill through our plug and countersink it so that we can attach it to the post. Notice I'm gonna actually be drilling off center because of the way that the location this plug sets on that post, we've got a cap on there and we don't wanna drill into that post hole plug. So I'm gonna drill off center. Now in this case, I'm gonna wanna waller those screws out a little bit because I wanna make sure the threads don't catch on this section here. So here I've got my countersink in there, my hole through. That allows my screw to come out the back and that'll engage in the quarter wall of the post. With our cap set in the right location and level, we're pre-drilling here into the post. Set our screws to hold that end cap in place. There we go. And that should do it. Now we're ready to mount our handrail to this end cap. Now we could put our double-sided tape on here, flip this over, mount it, mount the location that way. But that's a little bit complicated with a more with a number of pieces here all put together. So I'm going to show a different way of finding the center of this corner here so that I can locate my collar in the middle and get it lined up just over top of my post below. So what I'm going to do there is draw some lines, some square lines off of this side of the rail and off of this side. Okay. Now I have what is just under a 2-inch by 2-inch square. The handrail is slightly under 2 inches, part of meeting code for the grippability of it. Our collar is 1.5 inches, so that means we're setting in just under 1/4 inch from each side. I'll simply set my collar on there and make sure that I'm falling just a touch under that 1/4 inch in each direction. That is right where we want that collar to set, right there. So I'm going to go ahead and get my first screw head started. With that marked, I can pre-drill and run my first screw in. There we go. I'm going to double check to make sure that I'm centered up right where I want to be on that. All right, looks pretty good. I'm going to go ahead and drill my next hole and get this set. There, we've set that collar just where we want it. We're going to go ahead and test fit our assembly here. Make sure we're ready to set our next collar on this corner here. And we should have this fairly complex section of handrail ready to mount to the posts. All right, here we're at that stair transition piece, and we're figuring out where to mount this collar to this handrail. Again, I could use the double-sided tape, but this is a particularly complex set of handrail that taking it on and off is a little tricky. So I've got it set now, so I'm gonna go ahead and just mark it with a pencil at each one of those spots along here. And that will give me what I need to be able to sight this on the underside of this handrail. So now we're going to take this off, flip it over, mount the collar on, and we'll be ready to set our handrail in place. Here we've set our three-piece handrail section in place. We've tightened the set screws on the collars, so this section of railing is finished. Next, we're going to transition down the stairs and add sections down to the bottom of the steps. So here we are at an intermediate post on the stairway. The top on the intermediate is fastened with this 1/4-20 set screw, and you can reverse that top either direction, and you can pivot that top. So you can see there, you can pivot that top. So what we're going to do here is we're going to pivot it to the slope of our stairs, accessing the mounting holes, and tighten that back down here. I'm going to take a look through there and make sure I'm just about right. Looks like we're getting real close there. I'll set my angle finder on there and make sure I've got the right slope. Next, I'm going to measure from the end of my handrail to the bottom of the stairs, catching the front edge of those bullets. So that's the spot where I'm going to make that same mitered cut for the transition from straight to sloped of the stairs. It's the same cut that happens at the top of the stairs. It's the same process of measuring from the front of the bullets, and that underside of the handrail is where that miter is going to start. We'll show you that next. Here we're at the bottom of the stairs. We're trying to find the point where our handrail is going to be cut. And remember, we mentioned that that's at the face of the bullet. So I've got this mark here, face of the bullet. I'm bringing my just a scrap of handrail to that point there. That gives me the point at the bottom on the underside of the handrail where we're going to have the miter cut to transition into a straight run. So I'm going to be measuring from my the end of my last handrail there, and I'm coming down, and I am right at 135.5. 135.5 will give me just about what I need there. We have our pieces cut for the last section of handrail down the stairs. We have one long section here. We have a shorter section that will butt onto that with a structural spline and has a miter cut here at the bottom that transitions to the straight section at the bottom of the stairs. The reason for doing this transition at the bottom of the stairs and at the top of the stairs, there's two reasons. One, the modern top on the tensioning post does not pivot, okay? Number two, even if it did pivot, you really don't want to run your handrail over the top without transitioning to a straight section over top of the post, because the inflection point of the cable is at the face of the bullet, okay? And because of the geometry of that, if you run over top of the handrail, you will have too wide of a gap at the bottom of the stairs between the underside of the handrail and the cable. And at the top of the stairs, you'll have the exact opposite problem where the handrail will be too close to the cable. So in order to not create a problem with misaligning the cable to the handrail, but to keep those parallel, you always, every time you're transitioning from straight to sloped on a stairs and then back at the bottom, you want to make that transition cut that follows the angle of the stairs, then back to level. So again, we're going to use a transition spline and an angled spline here to create that transition. And we will use a plug at the bottom of the stairs. Okay. On this last piece at the bottom of the stairs, if you want that handrail to end flush with the back side of the post away from the bullets, you've got an 1/8 inch worth of the cap, you have the thickness of the post right at 2 inches, and 1/4 inch of the face of the bullet. So we've got 2 1/4 inches from the face of the bullet to the back of the post. 1/8 of that will be used up by the cap. So this cut from this side here to this side here is at 2 1/8 inches. And that'll give you the right point for your angle to make the inflection to go up on your handrail, and the right distance to end your handrail at the back of the post. We'll go ahead and assemble these parts now and show you that system installed. Perfect. I like it. That completes the slope section of the stairway on one side. We've shown you straight handrail installations as well. With those two techniques, we can complete the rest of the installation for this project. Now that we've finished installing our handrail on this project, we're going to move on to installing the cable from tensioner to tensioner. Every tensioner comes with an associated crimp and lobed washer and the set screw that tightens the cable. So you should have as many of these components as you have tensioners. For the cable, we have some options for cutting that. We have a hand cutter that you can use to cut the cable. It takes a fair bit of force. It will cut it. We have a slightly longer cutter that makes the cutting a little easier. And then for production jobs where you're doing a lot of cutting, you might want to invest in a larger cutter here. This makes it real easy to cut the cable. It's a bench top, so you can bolt it down to a top and cut it right off. So several different options for cutting the cable. Once you've cut your cable, you're going to take a lobed washer first. That always goes on first. Slip that on. Slip on a crimp. And now we're going to show you the use of our crimping tool here. This comes with a set of jaws that are designed just for the right size stop here. The knob on the side releases the cylinder in the middle. You can fit that right in, tighten up the knob, and begin the hydraulic press. And with a few good firm, you'll close those jaws right up. This is putting several tons of force on that crimp, and you can see we've got a nice hexagonal crimp on the end of that cable. That is how we crimp the cable assemblies. When we're going to show you next a section using it on a post here, we'll be fastening the cable in on one end, pulling it tight to the other, measuring the length, cutting it to length, and then repeating that process. We've pre-cut some cable to a rough length for this project here. I've already got one end crimped, as we showed you earlier. To get this started in the tensioner, I'm going to put a little T9 bow shield in there. That is an anti-seize, anti-galling liquid, and it's also going to help prevent any tarnishing in there and allow for that screw to run in easily. I'm going to set my crimp and lobed washer in the bullet. Use my set screw and Allen key. Tighten that up. And that is in there nice and firm. Now we're going to take this cable and run it through the spacer bars and intermediate posts as necessary to the other end and be ready to crimp and fasten that end. Here we're at the intermediate, our first intermediate post from our tensioning end. Got the cut end of my cable. I have a spacer bar that's going to fit into this section, so I want to make sure I've threaded my cable through that top hole in the spacer bar and through the intermediate. Now, what I'm going to do next here is put a little piece of tape around this spacer bar and hold it next to this intermediate post. It ensures that I'm always going to be running my cable through the intermediate post. It also takes the weight of the spacer bar off of the cable as I'm pulling it tight. Once I've finished my section and start to tighten my cables, I'll pull the spacer bar to the middle of the section and secure it in place. But now I'm just pulling it off to the side with my cable threaded through there. I'm going to use a little painter's tape here. Secure that in place. And we'll take that on to the next section. So here we've pulled our cable to our length. We've put a piece of 3/4 inch painter's tape along this post here. What that does is it gives me a mark that's 3/4 of an inch past the post, which this cable bullet face is 1/4 inch. So that gives me my 1 inch past the face of the tensioner. So where I want to cut this cable off. So you can see that gives me a visual that I'm the right length. Okay. With that cable cut, I'm going to install the lobe washer first, the crimp ring, and with the crimp flush to the back side of that cut cable, I'm going to crimp this end of the cable. There we have a crimped end. We're ready to slip it in to the face of the tensioner, and we'll chase that with our set screw to tighten up this run of the cable. There, now that we've got this cable set, the cable's not fully tensioned yet, but we've got it secured on both ends. I'm going to be running the rest of my cable, and when I'm done running the rest of my cable, I'll go through and tighten each one of these set screws to draw that cable nice and tight. So here we're starting in the middle, and we're going to tighten up the middle strands first and then work towards the outside. You'll need to repeat that process probably a time or two, as you tighten the cables, they'll introduce a little bit of stretch, and you're taking that stretch out of the cable. Now you can see our cables are getting fairly tight here in the middle. We'll keep going until they're good and tight. We've got our cables tightened up here now, and they've got a pretty good tension to them. They have about the sound of a bass guitar string there when you get them good and tight. Those could go just a bit tighter. So I'll finish tightening these up, then I'll move my spacer bars to the middle and tighten those down as well here. So one more pass, starting in the middle, tightening to the outside. We'll get these nice and tight. And again, we'll move our spacer bars into position and lock those down. Now with our cables properly tensioned, we're going to move our spacer bar to the middle of this run. And we'll check that distance there. Right there is where we want it, right there. Each spacer bar comes with a set screw in the top. And that set screw just gets turned down in until it makes contact with the cable. And it locks it in place. You can do the same at the bottom. Two and a half.
It's right there. Oh. Perfect. And tighten that down. There we go.
And there, our spacer bar is securely fastened in place. And what that spacer bar will do is limit the deflection. So when you're pushing down on that cable here, it stops deflecting at that point where the spacer bar secures it to all the others and ties that whole piece together, making it quite rigid and maintains your spacing and helps meet code compliance with deflection on a run. With these spacer bars, we're able to set our posts farther apart. So it can be a real benefit to having a less costly system. And also, because they're so slender, it gives you a nice clear view through the cable. We'll continue setting our spacer bars down through this section, and then this section will be finished. All right, with setting this last spacer bar here, we finished this section. Our side mount posts have been mounted and leveled, our top rail installed, cables installed and tensioned, spacer bar slid into space and affixed, and that is one complete section of cable railing for this deck. We'll follow these same steps to complete the rest of the sections of this deck and complete the project. Thanks for watching this installation video for a cable bullet. If you have any questions, feel free to call us, email us, or leave a comment on this video.